I've seen the new British army drilling in London, Mr. Britling. I don't know if you have. I saw a whole battalion, and they hadn't got half a dozen uniforms and not a single rifle to the whole battalion. You don't begin to realize in England what you are up against. You have no idea what it means to be in a country where everybody, the women, the elderly people, the steady middle-aged men, are taking war as seriously as business. They haven't the slightest compunction. I don't know what Germany was like before the war. I had hardly gotten out of my train before the war began. But Germany today is one big armed camp. It's all crawling with soldiers, and every soldier has his uniform and his boots and his arms and his kit. And they're as sure of winning as if they had got London now. They mean to get London. They're cocksure they are going to walk through Belgium, cocksure they will get to Paris by Sedan Day, and then they are going to destroy your fleet with Zeppelins and submarines and make a dash across the Channel. They say it's England they are after in this invasion of Belgium. They'll just down France, by the way. They say they've got guns to bombard Dover from Calais. They make a boast of it. They know for certain you can't arm your troops. They know you can't turn out 10,000 rifles a week. They come and talk to anyone in the trains and explain just how your defeat is going to be managed. It's just as though they were talking of rounding up cattle. Mr. Britling said they would soon be disillusioned. Mr. Durick, with the confidence of his authentic observations, remarked after a perceptible interval, "I wonder how." He reverted to the fact that had most struck upon his imagination. Grown-up people, ordinary, intelligent, experienced people, taking war seriously, talking of punishing England. It's a revelation, a sort of solemn enthusiasm, high and low. And the trainloads of men, and the trainloads of guns. Liège, said Mr. Britling.